good morning. Good morning, and thank you for this opportunity to participate in this critical discussion. The question is, what must we do to create a food system which universally moves the world from hunger to health and sustainability? How do we develop a shared commitment for a more sustainable future? Thinking comprehensively, how do we create the public will globally and domestically to ensure our government leaders, business leaders, civil society, in other words, all of them and each of us will support the difficult public policy changes, the regulatory changes, the business operation changes, the financial investment changes, the community, household, and dare I say it, the personal changes required. The changes required to achieve the audacious goal of creating a sustainable food system capable of meeting our human health needs while eliminating the detrimental environmental impact our food system today creates. You're right, it's no simple undertaking. But as former President Obama was often heard said to say, hard things are really hard. Yet, these hard things we must do to fix the business of food, fix the food system from farm through consumption to disposal, ensuring everyone, everywhere, maintain sustainable, durable access to affordable, nutritious food. In recent days, as the climate summit began, COP25, it convenes from, we're hearing comments from far too many leaders across the globe reflecting the sentiments of the privileged, attempting to dispel any sense of emergency, ignoring the scientific data to suggest no need for alarm. Yet the most recent data suggests the breakdown of the food system is the biggest threat of climate change. It is also true, the data suggest, under future climate projections, tropical areas, particularly in Latin America, Central America, and Southern Africa and Southeast Asia, where 85 to 90% of the population will live by 2100, that these areas would disproportionately face lose-lose situations with exposure to lower agriculture productivity and lower maximum fisheries catch potential by 2100. While conversely, the data would suggest that countries situated at high latitudes, e.g. Europe and North America, where food, jobs, and revenue dependencies on domestic agriculture and seafood production are generally lower, that these areas will experience losses of lower magnitude, or even gains in some cases, for example, Russia or Canada, that we under the future climate conditions. But I enthusiastically accepted the invitation to speak here today because what you as leaders recognize is that a food system crisis over there represents a food system crisis everywhere. You recognize waiting for crisis and effectively performing or handing out boxes of food to those when and where needed. You realize while these actions are necessary to ensure no one goes hungry, these actions will not move those in need from hunger to sustainable health and opportunity. You sitting here at 9 o'clock in the morning recognize that while hard things are indeed hard, A dystopian future is not the only possible or even probable future. Because you know our history. You know where in 1959 at the Ford Foundation meeting, a noted economist of the time is quoted as having said, "At best, the world outlook is grave. At worst, it is frightening." And because during that same period, biologist Paul Ehrlich allegedly predicted that famines, especially in India, would kill millions in the 1970s and 80s. But we worked together as a community of actors, and the Green Revolution overcame those grim visions by transforming Africa, particularly in agriculture, particularly in Southeast Asia, especially wheat and rice. Yes, we avoided projected famines, but as students of our history, you ask, at what cost? Was the price we paid too high? Because you note, with a projected 2050 population growth of 9.5 to 10 billion people, we need to increase today's agricultural production by some 56%. And using today's agriculture technology, even if there was no climate impact and global pasture production rates remained steady, we would need to cultivate 593 million additional hectares, an area nearly twice the size of two Indias. Talk about biodiversity loss. Talk about loss of trees, because this would mean the demand for arable land will require clearing most of the world's remaining trees. You know that it's not just about biodiversity, that the state of our system, that agriculture is responsible for approximately 70% of the freshwater withdrawal, contributing to freshwater stress affecting some 2 billion people today. You know 830 million people suffer from food insecurity, while more than 1.9 billion are overweight, with an additional 650 million suffering from obesity. That the double burden of malnutrition is increasing across the developed world and the developing world, particularly in emerging economies, where increases in income result in an adaptation of a more Western diet, more salt, more sugar, more starches. And as the WFP recently noted, Lauren and her team recently noted, the nutrition team, in El Salvador, 1 in 6 children have chronic undernutrition, and 6 out of 10 adults are overweight or obese. And we know the challenges of hidden hunger, more scientifically known as micronutrient deficiency, affects some 2 billion people, and that by 2030, some researchers suggest half the world's population will suffer from one or more of these three forms of malnutrition. A Rockefeller Lancet study offered a data-supported solution to addressing these food system challenges, suggesting improving the food system will require research, innovation, governance, policy changes, as well as imagination. I would add, my own research and experience says two more requirements are necessary: adequate financing and collective multi-sectoral action. Your report, Fixing the Business of Food, also underscores the need for partnership. Yes, the data confirms new research and technology-driven solutions are coming online. The challenge is moving research and technology solutions beyond programs and pilots into sustainable, durable solutions. Sustainable as a three-legged stool of good for people, good for the planet, as well as profitable. Large multinationals, including Barilla, are coming online with new solutions, as you outline in your Fixing the Business of Food report. Small and medium business enterprises are also driving improvements in diets through new ag tech, food tech, and food system-related innovations. In fact, in 2018, 1,450 deals were financed in the agri-food tech sector by 2,000 unique investors. In fact, not only are more deals coming online in this space, more money is flowing into the food and agriculture sector. In 2019, $16.9 billion was invested across 1,000 agri-food tech startups and SMEs. Yet, none of these businesses are focused on addressing the challenges of low-income or underserved people. So through a grant from the Rockefeller Foundation and working with colleagues from Stanford University, we pursued a year-long project of research and interviews where we confirmed that because of time and return requirements of venture and equity capital, SMEs and mid-sized businesses are required to focus on the affluent and at best a middle-class income for markets. In our survey of representative business owners, we learned most are not averse to serving low-income or underserved communities, but they lack the adequate capital and, as a result, the business capacity to serve these communities. And outside the United States and Europe, the finance challenges are even more daunting. SMEs and mid-sized businesses in low- to middle-income countries are seen by finance money seen by finance as well as asset owners and asset providers as challenging to finance because of the perception of inherent business operational risk in the market, and too often not as investment ready because of limited collateral, short credit, and business operations history, thin margins, and uncertain projects for scale. But our research showed the challenges in the food system, both domestically and internationally, could be overcome by government and businesses working together. Not just multinationals, but those mid-sized businesses and SMEs through investments in the capital stack that would catalyze outreach to underserved and low-income communities. But recognizing that funding alone will not overcome the enabling environment issues or the consumer demand conundrum, we crafted a new model for financing food system SMEs and mid-sized companies with the goal of delivering not just competitive financial returns, but also measurable nutrition access and nutrition impact. You know, as I stand here before you today, I talk about business because accessing the food, the nutritious food that is necessary, should not require a mother to stand in line. Every mother should have the ability to access, through her own resources, affordable, nutritious food. I never met a mother who proudly stood in a line for food. Also, when we're honest, our work of providing food is a treatment, but not a cure. It's an important treatment, but it's not a cure. A cure is creating market-based tools that can sustainably and consistently provide that affordable access to safe, nutritious food, giving that mother the opportunity to proudly shop for healthy, diverse foods for her own family. Our reality knows that no one business can change consumer demand or deliver measurable nutrition impact, which is why collective actions, partnerships to produce the policy and regulatory action necessary to support the enabling environment for the effective operation of businesses is so critical. tackling global food challenges, overcoming the projected malnutrition challenges is a complicated journey requiring multi-sectoral actors with a variety of skill sets, financial resources, and networks for delivering action. Any success we hope to create on the road will require an ever-widening of the circle. There must be room for all ideas, for all actors, activists, influence, financiers, as well as consumers. Bringing communities and consumers along will require businesses as well as government reinforcing the chain of trust, not just through a commitment to safe and secure food systems, but demonstrating through real action, real, genuine concern and care beyond profit. Not just embracing food as medicine, supporting access to nutritious food when low-income and vulnerable people are sick, but embracing food as health, health for all, bringing solutions online that are affordable and available for all. I would be remiss if I left the stage and didn't talk about the need for bringing women, youth, and indigenous populations into this conversation, particularly as I look out on this audience today. Because stakeholder involvement demands we listen as much as we talk. I had the benefit of sharing a stage with a Ugandan farmer where she reminded our European and American audience nothing about us without us. That fixing the broken food system is not about a hand up, a hand out, but a hand up. Facilitating business opportunities that help communities we serve help themselves. Creating a future world, tackling the global food challenge, with a global food system that universally delivers human health and supports our planetary health is possible and achievable. But we must consider all, not just those in the room, not just those who look like us, not just those that we can see. We must consider both the developed and the developing world, the affluent and the middle class, as well as the low income and underserved. Creating a shared commitment will require each of us standing up for something not personally about us, not about you, but about all of us, and working together to achieve that shared goal for our one planet. Let me close with a few words my experiences have taught me. Unity of mission, as we sit here, we all agree on the need to move forward. But unity of mission is only the beginning. Unity in your actions is indeed progress. But unity together in achieving our shared goal, now that is success. Tackling global food challenges with unity, leaving no one behind in our solutions or in our conversations. It seems hard. No, in fact, it almost seems impossible. But I'll lean on the words of former President Nelson Mandela, who said, yes, it always seems impossible until it is done. It will take each one of us working together, not independently, but interdependently, with unity, with all. And we will get it done. Thank you.